You know what, it really sucks having absolutely nothing to ramble about. Because every time I start one of my videos, all I can think about is how unexciting my life is. Like, I have nothing to say ever anymore, and whenever I film, all I wanna do is talk. Like, that's just my human nature. I just wanna fucking ramble, and I wanna talk, and I have nothing to say. And it sucks. It sucks. So, hey y'all, today we're reading Let's Not Meet Stories. Every time I film a video, I'm like, I just have to hop right into it. Like, what is this? Who am I? So I went onto the subreddit Let's Not Meet and I took some of the top stories of all time. I took the top three of all time. So these are gonna be fucking good. Like, I haven't read them yet, but I know they're gonna be good. We'll do like the very top story last. So we're gonna do like the third top, then the second top, and then the very top story of all time. So the first story says, sociopath kidnapper in supermarket parking lot. My husband and I were at the supermarket and our baby was being especially fussy, so we took her for a quick drive, the motion of which usually calms her down. It only took about 10 minutes to settle her and I was still in the store, but unsure of how much longer I would be there and there's poor cell reception inside. So he pulled back into the parking lot to wait for me. It was an unseasonably nice day, so he took her in her car seat to sit on one of the benches outside the store. He took a business call and I just sat them down, absentmindedly rocking the carrier when a woman, well-dressed, mid-30s, average height, fit build, approached them. It's not uncommon for people to ask to play with our baby. She's got big rosy cheeks, soft whips of gold hair, and the most adorable gurgly toothless grin, especially when she's deep into a good nap. But her nap schedule is paramount, so my husband was preparing to tell the woman she actually couldn't play with our baby right then. She walked over right in their direction, brimming with nonchalant confidence, and before he can even finish his sentence explaining she was napping and not to be touched, she picked up the carrier and started walking off. He was in shock for a minute, not fully believing someone would be ballsy enough to do something so sinister in plain daylight, so he said, "Excuse me, put her down," as his panic mounted. She remained calm this entire time, but when he called after her, she started walking away more briskly than when she'd approached. He ran full speed ahead, trying to grab the carrier out of her hands, finally resulting to restraining her arms. The woman yells, "Help! He's trying to take my baby! Kidnapping! 911, help!" Kicking him in the shin and pulling a pink bottle of pepper spray out of her handbag. Oh my god, this is off to a fucking crazy start. Of course, no one in the parking lot was clocking the earlier interaction and assumed he really was a kidnapper. A lone man in a Deadpool t-shirt versus a tiny, well-dressed woman. Immediately, a man knocked my husband to the ground and was holding him down. He could hear bystanders encouraging the woman to file a police report, but she was doing a very convincing job of acting shaken up and insisted she just wanted to get home. To make matters worse for my husband, she was driving a minivan. He was in a raw state of panic, realizing the entire parking lot had banded together to inadvertently facilitate the kidnapping of our daughter. He was begging and pleading with them, but no one was listening. They just kept screaming at him that the jig was up and he needed to lie still and wait for police and stop terrorizing a young mother. My husband finally had the novel idea to show them family pictures on his phone, but too panicked to think clearly, this manifested as him shouting, "I have pictures of the baby on my phone." Which of course, everyone interpreted him as him having either stalking photos or worse, pornographic images of the baby. It was at this point that a man, I can't entirely blame the man considering what he thought was going on, kicked my husband as hard as he could in the ribs. It was at this point I was coming out of the store and I thought he was being robbed by these people. I was yelling for security, so panicked my chest constricted and I could barely get any sound out. It was only then I realized he did not have our baby with him. When I saw she was being held by a woman, I was relieved. I thought maybe the woman had intervened to move my daughter out of harm's way while my husband was being robbed and was walking away to get help. I couldn't find a security guard outside the store, so I ran up to the people holding my husband down, waving my wallet, pleading, "Take everything you want, just let up and leave us alone." And one of the men holding him down said something like, "Lady, we need to wait for police to deal with him." And I was so confused. Why would the muggers have called the police? I kept stammering, "What do you mean? What are you talking about?" And made out someone saying he tried to abduct that woman's kid. I did not understand and was sure I'd misheard him. My husband would never hurt a child, and we have 4 kids. If we were going to commit a crime, bringing home another kid would be at the bottom of the list. I kept trying to understand what the man was saying, and suddenly, it all clicked. I looked around for the woman who had the baby carrier, and she was halfway across the parking lot. I went into total ballistic tiger cub mode, literally leapt out of my heels and sprinted across the parking lot. I'm not a UFC fighter. I've never even taken a self-defense class, so all I could think to do was grab the woman by her hair and squeeze her throat with my other hand, which didn't do much. She was getting away even as I grabbed her. Amazingly, none of the other bystanders had yet to connect that my, I cannot say this sentence for the life of me. None of the other bystanders had yet to connect that my husband was telling the truth and this woman was absconding with my baby. That took me so long to read. I don't know why. I yanked on her hair as hard as I could, and that was enough to make her drop the carrier. I was so scared and surprised that I actually just threw myself on top of the carrier, covering the entire thing like a blanket. And I stayed that way without saying or doing anything else. The woman left. Not one person tried to stop her. Even though she was clearly leaving without the child she claimed was hers, which would be pretty damn incriminating if I'd watched this scene unfold. Within the next couple minutes, police had arrived. After all that, there were still several bystanders who explained it as my husband trying to kidnap the baby. The police, to my horror, assumed that she must not have had bad intentions. The first questions they asked me after getting her description weren't investigative. They were questions thinly veiled trying to convince me not to pursue charges. Still placing blame on my husband. What the fuck? A small sampling. Do your husband and the baby look dissimilar? Is there a chance she thought he was abducting the baby and she was trying to intervene? Could your husband have been doing something inappropriate or violent to the baby that would make her feel compelled to extricate the baby from the situation? What the fuck? Did she seem groggy or confused? Could she have mistaken either of them for her own family members? They spent more time verifying that the baby was actually mine than they concerned themselves with the fact that the baby was not actually hers. My husband had called his brother at that point, who works in an office with a lot of lawyers, and connected with one ASAP, who gave us the priceless advice to get every officer's name and badge number, to request copies of the store security tapes right away, and to escalate our complaint higher up the chain if these officers weren't taking us seriously. Finally, we had reason enough to believe we were being taken seriously, and we went home. We both just shook and cried until we had to get our kids from school. My husband is seething with rage and grappling with a feeling of helplessness from how little he was able to do, and had two cracked ribs from when the man kicked him. To the officer's credit, they did ask if he would like to press charges, but considering the man was genuinely convinced at the time that he was on the right side of intervening in a kidnapping and stayed to talk to police and apologize profusely when the truth became clear, he declined to press charges. That's honestly good for him. I'm kind of with you. If you thought somebody was being kidnapped, like, wouldn't you do the same thing? I guess I probably wouldn't just, like, kick somebody. I don't think I would be able to do very much, but you know what I mean. Amazingly and frustratingly, there were still people who stuck around to talk to police who were giving my husband dirty looks, and one man who even implored the police to involve CPS to verify it was really our baby. Parking lot kidnapper and parking lot skeptics, you better hope we don't meet. And then someone commented, the whole story made me angry. I put down my phone and explained it to my boyfriend because I was visibly pissed off reading it. That's how I feel. Like, I'm just fucking mad. I'm just mad and I'm scared. Like, I'm scared for you. That's such a terrifying thing to have to go through. I told you guys these stories were gonna be fucking intense. And then this next one says, my brother saw a ghost as a kid. 2 decades later, and I realized what he actually saw. I was about 7 years old, my brother about 10. It was well past our bedtime when our mom woke up off the couch to put us to bed. Our dad worked construction out of town back then, so it was often just 3 of us at the house for weeks at a time. Up the stairs and to the immediate right was our parents' bedroom. Going left put you in the middle of a hallway. Taking another left down that hallway led to my brother's room. The opposite end was my room, which was also across the hall from our upstairs bathroom. At either end of the hallway, our window doors we always kept locked and rarely used. The door on my end led to a balcony overlooking our front yard, and the door on my brother's end opened to our back porch. The house kind of leans onto a small hill. My brother and mom both had a habit of waking up in the middle of the night to use the bathroom. I only knew this because I was always a light sleeper, and they couldn't help flushing with the door wide open. This night, however, my brother stopped on his way to his room and came back towards the bathroom. I'm gonna try to pee before I go to bed. The past few nights I've been too afraid to walk to the bathroom. I keep seeing a man wearing stripes at the end of the hallway. I don't know if my mom wrote it off as my brother telling ghost stories to try and scare me, or if she was already half asleep and didn't catch it, but she didn't react at all to my brother's confession. I, on the other hand, was terrified by it. The fear of seeing a ghost like that at the end of the hallway or through the window is the reason I started running from the stairs to my bedroom at night. Years later, when I was about 18, my mom and I were having a conversation in her car about a dog we had for a very short time when I was little. We were sharing stories about Max's tendency towards destroying my shoes or other unruly behaviors when my mom blurted out, "Do you remember that time I opened the front door for the cops and Max ran inside to the kitchen and started tearing open that big bag of dog food we had?" This really caught me by surprise because in all the years I lived in that house, we never once called the cops. I asked her what she was talking about and she looked equally surprised as if she had just revealed something by accident. "Oh, that's right. I never told you because you were too young at the time." One night, I woke up hearing noises outside my window, and when I looked, I saw a man staring into my bedroom. She went on to describe how turning on the lights caused him to take off running, and how she grabbed my dad's pistol before calling the cops. I can't remember all the details I gave them when they showed up. Tall white male, wearing a striped shirt and jeans, short dark hair, something like that. They said it matched the description of a man they were looking for in the area. It turns out he had escaped from jail on a murder charge. I'm in disbelief right now. Now, I know it sounds so obvious hearing those two stories back to back, but it wasn't until a few years ago in my mid-20s that I pieced together that my brother had unknowingly warned us about a murderer who had spent multiple nights casing our home. You're joking. You're fucking joking right now. You're kidding? Oh my god. And then someone was like, he was in your house? He was in it? But he wasn't actually in the house. There was a window. There was a window at the end of the hallway. I think that's why he described in detail how the upstairs was laid out. But regardless, you're okay. And then this last story says, the man on my patio. And this is the top story on Let's Not Meet of all time. Okay, so this happened when I was around 9 years old. I'm 25 now. And it's something I will never forget. It gives me goosebumps to this day. I lived in a terraced house, four houses combined, and my neighbors and I each had our own little patio. There's a small road 10 meters from my yard where people do their Sunday walks and so on. Only a small fence separates my small yard and patio from the road. I live in a pretty crowded area, with several of those terraced houses spread around in the neighborhood, so seeing people walking out on that road is pretty normal for me. Seeing random people standing on my patio is not. When I was 9, I usually got home from school about an hour before my mom got home from work. I lived maybe 50 meters away from school, so my mom figured I was mature enough to be home alone for an hour before she got home. This one day, I got home from school. I did the usual thing, which was to make sure I locked the front door and double-check that the back door leading to the patio was also locked. I was 9. Being alone was a little scary, even though it was in the middle of the day and only for an hour. I then rushed to my room upstairs to play as much PlayStation as possible before my mom came home and made me do homework. While playing, I heard this noise coming from outside my window. My room was located one floor over the patio, with a view to the road I told you about before. It was kind of like the sound of a cat, but my cat had been missing for over 3 months. Hope sparked, and I thought, oh my god, did he finally come back? I ran downstairs to check if it was my cat, but the sight that met me gives me goosebumps just writing this. There was a guy standing on my patio. A tall guy with black hair covering half his eyes, making him look like a male version of the Ring Woman or something. I could hear him making high-pitched sounds, almost like a cat meowing. A brown liquid was running down from his mouth, and I could see him spitting out, my dad's stomped cigarettes. He was actually eating from the ashtray. I was frozen observing this, eventually snapped out of it and screamed so loud that the man must have heard it. He didn't react. He kept on eating from the ashtray. I ran upstairs to my room, locked the door, and called my mom, who called the cops. I've never been more terrified in my life. Laying in bed under my sheets, shivering with fear as I hear these creepy, high-pitched noises from the guy eating cigarette stumps from the ashtray on my patio. I kind of blacked out for a moment because the next thing I remember is the police arriving on the road by my yard. I hear them talking to the guy saying stuff like, "What are you doing? Get over here or we'll come down and arrest you," and so on. He didn't respond, but the high-pitched sounds were more frequent and louder. I decided to look through the window, feeling safe now that the cops were there. I could see two police officers standing by my fence, one man and one woman. I did not see the creepy man, however, because he was standing directly one story under me and my field of view. The police jumped the fence, and I remember hearing the creepy guy screaming louder than anything I have heard before. He charged the female officer with full force, and he fucking knocked her out cold. The male officer then immediately tased the guy, leaving him shaking on the ground, screaming still. The policeman struggled to keep him on the ground while putting handcuffs on him, but eventually made it. After a while, he managed to wake up the female officer, who seemed to be badly hurt. He called for backup and an ambulance, and then he sees me standing in the window above him. The expression on my face must have been something else, because he just looked at me and said, "I sure as hell hope you didn't see all that." I started to cry. By this time, a neighbor started to arrive wondering what the hell was going on. One of my neighbors, an elderly woman, made me come down and she took care of me until my mom came back home. The police took the creepy guy with them in the car and left. Before they left, they promised to come back and talk to us about what had happened. I don't know why, but my eyes are watering right now. Like, I don't know why I'm like freaking out so much at this, but my eyes are literally watering. This is where the story takes an unexpected turn. I can't read anymore because my eyes are like... The male police officer came back later that night and sat down with me and my mom to talk. He explained the guy on the patio was actually diagnosed with severe autism. He had escaped a facility where mentally challenged people lived, located around 5 kilometers from where I live. I think it's kilometers, it's KM. I'm just gonna, yeah. He explained the guy had actually been living in my house 5 years ago, but he had been forced to move where his mom, his only caretaker, died. The poor guy probably thought he would find his mom in the house. He missed the routines and he missed living there with his mom. Okay, this is really fucking sad, actually. Now I understand where the tears are coming from. The police had to move him from the house that time 5 years ago because he was extremely strong. From what I heard, he had extreme tensions in the body because of the autism, making his muscles grow stronger and stronger throughout the years. This was the reason he reacted the way he did when the police came this day. Still frightened, I told the police officer that he needed to make sure this would never happen again. He promised it wouldn't. After a few sleepless nights, my life got back to normal. The years went by and the guy didn't come back. Until 1 year ago. At this time, my mom and dad had moved out. I bought the house from them and I'm still living there today. I was enjoying my morning coffee on the patio when I see this random guy stopping on the road by my fence. He just stands there looking at me. I look at him and give him a nod. That's when I hear the high-pitched noises. Holy shit, it's him. His hair had turned gray, but the high-pitched noises made me realize. My head started racing and I instantly remembered the reason why he was back. I realized he must have managed to escape again. Because I kept my cool a bit longer than when I was 9, I started to realize how sorry I felt for the guy. 16 years later and he was back to look for his mom. I decided to carefully ask him if he wanted to come down to the patio. He instantly jumped the fence. I started to think he would knock me out like he did to that police officer. He didn't. He smiled. He looked at me and smiled. I offered him to sit down. He didn't respond. I offered him to come inside. He started laughing. We went inside. His face lit up. Pure joy. He was home. It reminded him of the life he had with his mom. It almost made me tear up. All of a sudden, he sat down on my couch, turned on my TV, and switched directly to cartoons. I observed him for a while. He was just completely focused on the cartoons. I just wanted him to enjoy the moment, so I didn't say anything to him. I realized I had to call the facility to let them know. The caretakers arrived 10 minutes later, and after a lot of convincing, he got back up, crying, and they went back to the facility. I called the facility 2 days later, and we made a deal. I have goosebumps right now. I have fucking goosebumps from this story. His name is Tom, and I now consider Tom my friend. Every Sunday, from the day he returned, Tom and his caretakers visit me to watch cartoons. They say it's the highlight of his week, and it makes my heart warm. Now, for several years, my thoughts were, let's not meet guy on my patio eating from the ashtray. Now my thoughts are, let's meet every Sunday to watch cartoons, my friend Tom. That is like the most, that is genuinely like the nicest thing I've ever heard in my entire life. I have goosebumps and my eyes are welling up. I will not cry because I am not a pussy. I will not cry, but I love Tom. I love Tom. It's like so fucking sad, but it's so like heartwarming at the same time. That is one of the best stories we've ever read. Even though it's not like an absolutely terrifying story, that is incredible. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed. I still haven't figured out how to fix the subreddit, so if you guys have any stories, you can send them to me on Twitter, Instagram, or you can send them to my email. I'll start looking through different social media platforms for different stories that I can read, but for now, this is just from the Let's Not Meet subreddit. But other than that, I'm gonna go. I love y'all. I will see you in the next one. I love Tom. Bye! Also, yes, I did dye my hair. I did dye my hair again. I do have a problem, and I will fully admit it. I just didn't really like how the dark hair looked with the short hair. I just felt like it just kind of looked like a blob, and so I wanted some, like, dimension. I don't really know. But I dyed my hair. Okay, see ya.